won't be able to cover also the four-dimensional case, the black string case. You can find some information in the notes that I upload. You will notice that the notes are handwritten, and the first two are more well handwritten than the last one. It's not working. Okay, perfect. So the last two lectures are, you will see, there are a lot of cancellations, especially the fourth one. But the fourth one will not be covered in this lecture. So if you want more information, you can find in papers, and maybe one day I'll put the lecture in tech, in LaTeX. Okay, so most of what I'm going to say today is contained in this paper to have a reference. In the notes, you will find references to other relevant papers on the subject. So let's go back to the black hole. Black hole in ADS 4 × 7. Now we have discussed the gravitational picture, so what are these black holes? Remember that there is a family of black holes with three independent magnetic charges and three independent electric charges. Yesterday we also, and the day before, we also discussed the localization in field theory. So the partition function corresponding to the index counting the microstates of this black hole is precisely what we discussed yesterday. And now we will apply to the dual of this theory. The dual of this theory is the famous ABJM theory, Aronny, Bergman, Jafferis, Maldacena, and is a three-dimensional Chern-Simons theory. Schema, I will use n equal to 2 notation. The theory is actually n equal to 8, or n equal 6 in general, and in for particular choice of Chern-Simons is n equal to 8. And a very convenient way of encoding the matter information is this quiver picture, where essentially for each node you assign a gauge group. So the gauge group is un times un. And the arrow correspond to matter field, an arrow going from here to there, AI, correspond to a field in the fundamental representation, say, of the first group, and anti-fundamental of the second. There are two guys here, so I goes from 1 to 2. There are also B fields that goes in the opposite direction, meaning that are anti-fundamental of the first group and fundamental of the second, and there are, again, two of them. There are Chern-Simons term that I can put, I put a label here, meaning that the first gauge group has Chern-Simons level K, Chern-Simons level, and the second group has Chern-Simons level minus K. So if you want a review about ABJM, also from the point of view of localization, there are many things that you can do. The three-sphere partition function, I can recommend this nice lecture by Marigno. That contains basics about ABJM, basics about localization, computation of localization, and many interesting things that you may need to know. Okay, so let me tell you briefly, I'm interested in holography in the Large N limit. So the things that are known about this theory, the relevant for us, are the following. So it has been known from holography since the 90s that the free energy of this theory on S3, essentially you evaluate the classical action in ADS4, in Euclidean ADS4, and you discover, mapping the parameter n, k to the supergravity value, that the free energy on S3 should scale like n to the 3 over 2. Actually, in more recent time with localization, we are actually able to compute this, and you will find in the Marigno lectures the computation and the result, and the result of localization on the trisphere is a different manifold. It's not the one that I'm considering. It's a different type of localization. It's this one, even with coefficient, scale like n to the 3 over 2, which is a funny behavior. The theory in general has n equal to 6 supersymmetry. In the special case where k equal 1 or 2, supersymmetry is enhanced to non-perturbatively to n equal to 8, and there is NSO8 R symmetry. This k equal 1 is the case that we will consider, okay? So the maximally symmetric case. One can be more precise, but roughly speaking, there is a regime where n is much larger than k. Then you have a weakly coupled supergravity background, and the supergravity background is just ADS4 times S7, and k just enter as a quotient of S7, okay? I will consider k equal 1 so that I really am in M theory. It's not that k different from 1 makes a big difference. The computation goes pretty much in the same way, but then, okay, I'm not completely sure about black hole. You have a quotient, so probably there are quantization considerations to be taken in account more carefully. And we actually never did it. So let's focus on k equal 1. For localization, doesn't matter too much. Then for global properties, it's an analysis that should be done. For k equal 1, everything is perfectly fine. There are no quotients to take and so on. I wrote this in n equal to 2 notations. And for the game I'm going to play, I need an R symmetry because I'm doing a topological twist. The full R symmetry is SO8R. We can easily find the Cartan subalgebra, the U1 to the 4 that I discussed the first day. For example, a basis, very simple one, is the following. Oh, sorry, I forgot a crucial, something very crucial. There is a superpotential, okay? There is a superpotential, which is important. The superpotential is quartic, and is very simple, is this one. A2B1, okay? So there is a superpotential that constrains the interaction of the fields. So what's the role of the superpotential in this localization business? I was telling you yesterday, is just to fix the global symmetry, the R symmetries, and so on. It will not enter explicitly in the computation. And if I select, I can select a basis of R symmetry in the following way. The only two, B1 and B2, I can choose 4 of them. Let me call it R1, R2, R3, R4. So I need to give charge to the chiral field. Inside the constraint is that the R charge of the superpotential should be 2. In the standard normalization. It's a matter of normalization, but in the standard normalization, you just want the dark charge of the superpotential. It's 2 because the superpotential is integrated over the square theta, and theta is charge 1, okay? So, and then it's easy to construct a basis of R symmetries. Let's say that I assign charge 1 to, charge 2 to A1, 0, 0, 0 to the other, or the other possible choices are just this one, okay? And this makes a sort of democratic basis in the set of all R symmetries. For the twist, for the topological twist, we said yesterday we need to choose an R symmetry. There are many, so you can choose whatever you like, and you will get a different result, and I will show you how different. So let me write here the the index with the ingredients that we introduced yesterday, there is a sum over magnetic fluxes of the groups. In this case, the lattice of the magnetic fluxes, the gauge group is UN, is just Z to the N. So the you have a collection of vectors, I call it M and M tilde, and this vector have components that goes from 1 to N and are integers. You need for symmetry to divide by the Y group. Y group is just a permutation of the entries of a diagonal matrix in UN, so you get a factor N factorial square. And then the structure is an integral, contour integral, of the classical plus one loop contribution that I'm going to write in a moment. And there is a slight complication when you have genus greater than one, you need to take this guy, to take the log, take the determinant of derivatives of these guys with respect to the variable u and the variable m. And this is to the power g. So for example, for the sphere, we are g equals zero, this is absent, okay? And what is this z classical plus one loop? Using the rules that we learned yesterday, the only classical contribution comes from the Chern-Simons, okay? I have two groups, so I associate variables in the Cartan of the gauge group to the two groups. Let me call it U and U tilde. And then we always use yesterday the notation that whenever there is a U, I exponentiate and call the variable X. So I will have two set of variables. X and X tilde, or U and U tilde, as you prefer, you write in terms of X and X tilde. And the contribution of the Chern-Simons is just, as I wrote yesterday, the variable X to the Chern-Simons level K multiplied by the corresponding magnetic flux. So this is for the first group. The second group is similar, there is XI tilde. The Chern-Simons is opposite, so you put minus K and you put M tilde. This is the classical contribution. Then, so this is classical. Then there is the one loop determinant for the gauge field, and the one loop determinant is just a van der Mond determinant. You saw it in Diego lecture. So there is a van der Mond for the first gauge group. There is a van der Mond for the second gauge group, to some power that depends on the genus of the Riemann surface. And this is the vector contribution. Finally, you have the chiral fields. For each field, you have a particular rational function. So you have four contributions. Let me split in two sets, the A's and the B, that have different gauge representation. And the result is that you just sum over all overall elements of the representation. A and B are matrices, n times n matrices. So for each entry of this matrix, you put index I and j, and you get an expression like this. So for the, say, this is the A's, the expression is always rational. The A's are fundamental of this group, so I put X at numerator, are anti-fundamental of this group, so they have opposite charge, and I put X tilde J at denominator, this taking account the charge, and I put a fugacity that counts the global symmetry. Now we come back to the symmetry in a moment. So for a moment, just let me write this in this way. And I put this guy to some exponent. The exponent yesterday was written rho of m plus some external flux plus g minus 1 r alpha minus 1. Now, what is rho of m? You need to take in account the representation of your guy. So if this is a bifundamental guy, so xi divided x tilde j, here you will put mi with a plus, is on top, minus mj tilde. So the meaning of putting this rho is just count the weight of the guy. And I'll come back to this point in a moment. There is a it's convenient to parameterize these guys with integer, let me call it PA, and write this expression here, and I'll come back to this, in this way, introducing a particular integer that I call it P, like in supergravity, it will play the role of the magnetic charge of the black hole, okay? We come back in a second. These are the A's, there are two, and then there are the B's. So there are, so again, the, let me introduce an index A that goes from 1 to 4. 1 and 2 correspond to the A field, 3 and 4 correspond to the fields B, but the structure is pretty much the same. There is this rational function, and let me write, so there is the corresponding fugacity. This time, the guy is, in the fundamental of the second gauge group, so I put x tilde on the top, and in the fundamental, anti-fundamental of the first group, so I put this guy on bottom. And here I do something that you can read immediately, so this is on the top, I put m tilde I minus mj, and I put minus pa, and sorry, the blackboard is over, and again, plus 1 minus j. Okay, the structure is pretty much the same, okay? And A goes from 1 to 4 over the 4 guy. So you see, and then you have to integrate over, and the integration measure is just the xi over 2 pi I xi, the x I tilde 2 pi I xi tilde, xi tilde, sorry. Okay? So, what's the point here? In order to introduce external parameters, the y's and the p, I choose to use a sort of democratic point of view, to each of the field I assign something. So A1 is associated to y1, p1. A2 is associated to Y2, P2. B1 is associated to Y3, P3, and so on. B2 is associated to Y4, P4, okay? So these guys look like 4 chemical potential, 4 fugacities, and 4 magnetic charges for the symmetry that I have here. But remember that actually, the magnetic charges are not totally independent. You need to choose to fix a reference one, and with that cancel the spin connection. So there should be a linear combination of this P that is fixed by supersymmetry. And also the Y's at this point looks like fugacity. So it's like assign a symmetry to A1, global symmetry, a symmetry to A2, B1 and B2. But the index depends on global symmetries, not on R symmetry. The fugacity are fugacity for global symmetries. And there is a superpotential. Superpotential I cancel, unfortunately, is this one. So the global symmetry should respect this this superpotential, which means that the rotation in A1, rotation in B1, A2, and B2, the sum of all these rotations should be the identity. That this you can enforce by saying, okay, if I assign a fugacity to this guy, to this, and this, and this, the product of this guy is actually constrained to B1, okay? In order that the superpotential is invariant. Why in the notation that we introduced yesterday is again an exponential, precisely as x is the exponential of u, y is the same guy for a global symmetry, meaning that is e to the I, some guy, a Wilson line for the flavor gauge symmetry, plus I beta, and the real scalar in the flavor symmetry multiplet. For sake of simplicity, I will call this guy from now on, and there are A's here, simply delta A. So I will just use a letter where delta is a chemical potential, but I think that is complexified. Everything is complexified in this game. And what is the meaning of this guy? This is really a chemical potential. We see yesterday, this is the Wilson line of the flavor symmetry, meaning that this can be interpreted as trace minus 1 to the f, e to the minus beta h, e to the I delta f j. So delta f enters precisely as a chemical potential in the index. It's counting the states according to the electric charge of the states, okay? This is the real part of this guy. So you may ask, what is sigma? Sigma was mentioning yesterday. Sigma has always appeared in the Lagrangian multiplied by phi square psi psi. So it's a mass term. It's a real mass term for all the fields. So what's the role of this guy? Well, it will modify your Hamiltonian. So if you start with a quantum mechanic that is has many massless states, you're just introducing masses, real masses, for all fermions and bosons, and modifying a little bit the Hamiltonian. This is an important point because this will give you a regularization. If you look at the old paper on Witten index, the first basic thing that Witten says is, okay, take a quantum mechanics with a discrete set of states, and they must get and the gap between the vacuum and the first one. Whenever you have a continuum of states in the Witten index, you need to be careful. Usually it doesn't work. Well, sometimes it works, but most of the time it doesn't work. So the actual effort of this sigma is to regularize my theory, give mass to everything, so the result is really a Witten index. And so what I'm computing is what is typically called the equivariant Witten index, so you regularize in this way, at the end of the computation we'll send the sigma to zero, and I still will get an integer, okay? So taking account this, I'm regularizing my supposedly existent superconformal quantum mechanics in this particular way, which is a natural way, it's dictated by holomorphicity of the problem. Okay, so I will call this guy just delta for simplicity. For the, yeah, well, you will see how it enters the fact that these are complex. So this for the global symmetries, if the product of the guy is one, then the sum of the delta I is zero, or better, and this is you will, well, we will see that in this game there are many multi-valued functions, logarithms, so it's better to keep factor of 2 pi's, because otherwise you can get the wrong result because if you just forgot the monodromies of your theory. So the constraint is that the sum should be an integer multiple of 2 pi. This for the, the superpotential I had, I could avoid to write it again, okay. So what's about the R symmetry? Well, I choose a particular parametrization here. So this is what I yesterday call the exponent of each chiral field. It depends on G genus, okay, it's not particularly important. It depends on the choice of R symmetries. And the point is that in this theory, you have many different choices of R symmetry. So you can do many different choices, many different twists. The only constraint is that this guy here, let me call it this A, because I call A from 1 to 4 parameterize my fields. The only constraint is that since this A is running over A1, B1, A2, B2, and the R symmetry and the R charge of the superpotential should be 2, you can choose whatever you like here with the constraint that the sum over these guys is 2, okay? In the table, there were 4 possible choices. You can also take a linear combination such that the sum is 2. So I decided to reparameterize writing this, which is an integer, in this language, 1 minus g minus pa, where also p are integers. And can we do that? Yes, well, you just need to solve this equation and call pa the guy that appears here. since the sum of the ri is equal to 2, this guy will be also constrained. How? Well, you can sum over a here, you can sum over a here and see what you get. So when you sum the array, you get a factor of 2. When you sum minus 1, you have 4 factors, so you get minus 4. Here you will get 4 times 1 minus j minus the sum of the pa, which means that sum over the pa is equal to 1 minus j. Okay? In my parametrization, that's the constraint that you need to impose on the magnetic charges. This will be the field theory dual of what we wrote a couple of days ago. Remember that we wrote that in gravity, the sum of the p lambda is fixed to something. K was 1, minus 1, or 0. G, unfortunately, is not the genus in the gravity notation. It's the phi Heliopoulos, okay? So it's a different object, but, and also, obviously, this guy is not exactly this. It's this up to some multiplicative factor, okay? We will see exactly which one soon. So this is for the notation. Now I have 3 magnetic charges, independent. This will correspond to the 3 independent magnetic charges of the black hole. And I can introduce 3 independent chemical potential for 3 global symmetry of the theory. But remember that the black hole, we say a couple of days ago, depends only on 3 electric charges, not 4. So we are lucky. So we have enough ingredients to match the entropy of the black hole. Now, what you have to do now, I cancel this, which is just notations. So the trick to solve this this model in the Lagrange limit is the following. As I was mentioning yesterday, if I focus, for example, on the magnetic fluxes of one of the gauge group, you see that they always enter at exponent, but linearly. So there is always a structure inside the one loop integrand, which is what we wrote yesterday. You can write as MI multiplied by something. This something has a physical interpretation. You can rewrite as the derivative of a twisted superpotential of an effective two-dimensional theory, but it's not really necessary for the moment. You can explicitly check that you can write in this form for a function W that I'm going to write in a second. And the logic yesterday was, here there is a complicated contour, this Jeffrey Kirwan, but luckily enough, as in an example that I showed yesterday, the Jeffrey Kirwan chose in this lattice, essentially half of the lattice, say the positive m or the negative m, the positive m tilde, the negative m tilde. So the trick is the following. You use the geometric series to resum this guy here, and you will get an integrand that has a complicated numerator. And at the denominator, you have these guys here, the derivative of I, the w, respect to ui, the same for the derivative with respect w tilde, this is a tilde, multiply from 1 to n. Okay? So the structure of your integral, when you resum the magnetic fluxes, is simple. You have to do a contour integral. And the logic is that Jeffrey Kirwan essentially is there to tell you that just to take the poles that you see at the denominator. So you need to essentially solve these equations here, equal 1. I write only for one gauge group, but there is another one for U tilde, and which has a physical interpretation in terms of beta vacua of the two-dimensional theory, which are equivalent to derivative of this guy equal 2 pi ni, where ni is a certain integer. Again, these 2 pi's are overall, seemingly relevant, but no. If you set it to 0 and you choose the wrong determination for your multivalued function, you get nothing, okay? So it's crucial to keep everything, including factor of 2 pi's. So the set of the equation that you need to solve is this one, and there is the same for U tilde, okay? All the variable appear in a democratic way, the two groups appear in a democratic way. What is W? Well, you can use the formula that I gave you yesterday, which is a general formula for the twisted superpotential, or compute, okay? It's not difficult. And you can check easily that the form of W, U and U tilde, is the following. Sum over 1 to the n, 1 half. I'm setting k equal 1, okay? Otherwise, k would appear here, okay? This is the Chern-Simons contribution. The Chern-Simons contribution is quadratic in the fields. And each of the matter fields contributes this function that I already wrote yesterday, which is a polylog. And is this one, ui minus u tilde j plus delta a. And then there is another guy, which is minus sum over I j from 1 to n, li 2 e to the I u tilde I minus u j plus delta a. And here is, sorry, the sum is a equal, this was 3 and 4, this is 1 and 2. And this is a li 2. It's pretty much what I wrote yesterday. Essentially, this is the Chern-Simons contribution. Each matter field brings a li 2 because li 2 is essentially the object that you get in an effective Lagrangian by integrating out a set of Kaluza-Klein mode on a circle. So each matter field brings a li2. This corresponds to the gauge representation of your guys. Remember that x is e to the I ui. And here there is a minus sign. You can also write a formula with a plus because there are nice identities with the li2s. So the li2 of e to the I u is essentially equal to the li2 of e to the minus iu plus some polynomial term. So you can use some identity to write in a nice symmetric form. And the reason of this minus 1 is that the second gauge group has Chern-Simons opposite to the first one. So this is the function. And you need to solve this. And the point is that your index here at the end will be a sum over all the possible solution of these equations. And once you solve the equation, you plug it in this mess. You get something, you plug there, you compute the residue theorem. And so you need to be careful. You know, if you have a denominator, it's not just the numerator evaluated at the zero. Depends on the denominator. You need also to take the normalization of the denominator. So you do all of this, and you will get some expression. That is essentially the residue theorem applied to this guy, sum over all the solution of this set of equation. Now, we need to...
These are solutions between, you cannot solve it algebraically.
Okay, but there are solutions of this set of equation.
In principle.
Well, it depends what you call solution. In principle, solution is a solution of the set of equation, of this set of equation. Theorem, the...
You can solve it numerically.
Yes,
okay.
But still, so there is a set of solutions that you cannot find analytically. Still solutions, so, okay. Suppose that you can find analytically, you do this, okay? But I don't want to do this. The logic is the following. I want to study the problem in the Lagrangian limit. So what's the expectation? Here you have a sum. Say I want something that scale like the entropy, should go like n to the 3 over 2, so very big. So you will get a bunch of guys most likely here that goes like e to the n to the 3 over 2. And as usual, you use the saddle point. There's someone that will dominate over all the others in the Lagrangian limit. So what you expect is that there is a particular solution here that dominates the sum. In the saddle is the saddle point approximation. So you need to find essentially the solution, the saddle point of this set of equation in the Lagrangian limit. So now the point is to find the set of solution of this object. Well, this is a typical matrix model problem. Suppose that interpret UI and UI tilde as the set of eigenvalue of a matrix. It's pretty much similar to what Diego did for the Gaussian matrix model. You get a set of equations for the eigenvalue, then you need to solve in the Lagrangian limit. In the Lagrangian limit, there are many techniques to solve this kind of guys. The one that you saw with Diego, the traditional one, is to find a resolvent and use analyticity and so on. I would like to be able to do that. I don't know what the resolvent associated to this set of equations. If someone of you find it, please tell me, because you can do many other things. Honestly, all the tricks that you typically use doesn't work. In particular, the trick that Diego used here is not obviously working, essentially because in that trick there was a competition between a potential and a Coulomb repulsion. Here, essentially, the Coulomb repulsion is not there in the game. Essentially, this guy is not depending on M. Typically, the repulsion comes from the van der Monde. There is no M here, so this is just the contribution of the matter field. It's like having a matrix model with only the potential. Then what you do? You need to solve the equation, not to use trick like using resolvents and so on. So if you find a way of solving this in a more clean way, tell me, because it could be a very interesting result. But luckily enough, there are other ways of studying this problem in the Lagrangian limit. And curiously enough, this way of solving the problem has already appeared in other model. If you look at the Marigno lecture, you will see that for the matrix model on S3, on the contrary, there is a nice resolvent. Well, people were lucky. So the matrix model on S3 for ABJM can be mapped to a problem that has been solved in the past, where you know precisely the resolvent, everything, and you can use this trick. But in the literature, you will also find other papers in the Lagrangian limit by Klebanov, Pufu, Jeff Ferris, and collaborators, where instead of using the resolvent, they use another trick that has been used for three spheres, five spheres. So it's been used quite a lot in this business of localization. And the same tricks, I'll tell you what it is, works here. Let me maybe write one of these equations. There are two, okay? Let me write one just to see how it looks like when you take the derivative and exponentiate. Essentially, I was telling you yesterday the derivative of a polylog 2 is a polylog 1. Polylog 1 is the log. It's log of 1 minus x. So you can make, you can transform everything to a rational function. So if for j that goes from 1 to n, what you have to solve is for e that goes from 1 to n, what you have to solve is this set of equations. After some repackaging, you can write this rational set of equations. And you need to solve it in equal 1, and you need to solve it in the Lagrangian limit. This is the set of equations that you need to solve. Now, so what's the trick? Well, essentially what you can do is you take a laptop, you write the equation of motion, and you run some numerics, and you see how the eigenvalues are distributed. And what you discover running numerics is that the eigenvalues are distributed in a pretty curious way, which is one of the peculiarity of this kind of matrix model. The eigenvalues are such that the imaginary part of U grows with N. So if you look at the solution of the Gaussian matrix model that Diego shows a couple of days ago, eigenvalues are not scaling with N, they are bounded. In this case, instead, they grow. And then the trick is the usual one. In the Lagrangian limit, this guy becomes a continuous variable. You have so many, so you can introduce a continuous variable, a continuous function t such that These guys here are T evaluated in I over N. You can do the same for the real part. You introduce a continuous function V such that evaluated in I over N is VI, V tilde is I over N. And you can introduce a density of eigenvalues. This is precisely as in Diego set of lecture, which you can roughly speaking write in this way. The density is normalized such that the integral over the distribution of eigenvalue is 1. In this way, you typically can write a transformed discretized function W in a continuous functional of this variable here. T has become a continuous variable, T, that I use to parameterize some distribution of eigenvalue. And all the other guys become functions. You have a functional of the density and of the imaginary parts of the fields. Now, the interesting part of the story, this is different from other matrix models, is that due to the growing of eigenvalues with n, this guy here is a local function of the variable. Actually, can be written quite explicitly. The Chern-Simons contribution gives something like this. T, rho t. So one discovered that the only relevant thing is V tilde of t, which is the delta V of t, which is the difference between V tilde and V, okay? Essentially, you can see using age invariance that this is the only relevant object. So, and indeed, these guys actually only depend on this delta V, which is the difference. So there is this term, and there is another term that is a sum over the matter field. So there is this sum over A from 1 to 4 of some function. Let me call it G. It's very simple, and we write in a second. Of the delta plus delta A, where plus, you need to use plus when A is equal 3 and 4, and minus when A is equal 1 and 2. What is this G? Pretty stupid function. It's a cubic function. I will not do all the computation. Let me write so this is pi 2 u over 3. So it's a cubic function. So you see that everything is local and polynomial in all the fields. The chemical potential centers here. And this is the Chern-Simons contribution. Why is that? Okay, I don't have time to do all the computation, but the logic is the following. In the Li function, you have expression like this. So this is the argument of the Li function, Li2. Here for sure I will do mistakes, so you will correct me. So it's the sum of x to the n divided n to the k. Is that correct? Let's see. This is k indeed. I cannot get it right anytime. So Li n is should be this. Let's check the log. Li 1 is sum over x to the k divided by k. Okay, and the other are powers. So you see that for small value of x, this is a power series and it goes to zero. Okay. And the point is that you have this guy here with differences between ui and uj, but there is an I here. So typically, if I is greater than j, say, you have n to the alpha times something positive, and you have e to the minus n to the alpha, which goes to zero exponentially. So typically, when, say, I is greater than j, let me see, or j is greater than I in this notation, I think j greater than I, this is very small, so it's suppressed. When, on the other hand, when I is greater than j, you seem okay to say, okay, well, I'm in trouble, the guy blows up, and you need to study how the Li2 behaves at infinity. But you discover, I was mentioning before, that there are identities on the Li2. For example, Li2 of e to the iu plus Li2 of e to the minus iu. So it's just a polynomial. It's a polynomial. Okay, I don't need to write a specific polynomial. It's a quadratic polynomial. Very simple. So that when this guy blows up, you can replace with something that goes to zero plus a polynomial. So you just get polynomials. If you naively plug it, this behavior in the W that I wrote before, you will discover that it soon seems to grow too fast with n, but when you do the explicit computation, you discover that the nasty part that goes with bigger power of n cancel. And if you also choose in a clever way this angular ambiguity that I was mentioning before, you can see that all the nasty stuff goes away, and this is the final result, which is local because essentially only the contribution where I is almost J matter. Okay? This is the computation that you can find in the paper. It's not the full computation is not a simple one, but it's not particularly complicated mathematically. But you just need to be careful about all things, integers and things like that. So this is the final result, polynomial. And you see that here there are different powers of n. So that the point that you choose this alpha in this way, you want some competition between the two terms in order to find a solution. So it's better that this guy is equal to this one. And in this way, you find that the correct scaling, this you can check numerically, is alpha equal 1/2, such that this is n to the 3 over 2. This is n to the 3 over 2. And remember, n to the 3 over 2 is precisely the scaling limit that you expect for theory of M2 brains. So once you have this expression here, you can solve it. Now is a yes.
Yeah. So this dependence on the difference V tilde minus V, so you argue this from gauge invariance? What
gauge invariance because because U and U tilde, essentially this is I equal, is getting contribution from I equal J, right? So it's like take the U1 associated to I and J, V transform with positive charge, V tilde transform with negative charge under gauge transformation, so whatever is not, the sum can be gauged away, essentially.
So then this will be true for if you keep expanding this in higher orders in lower order in n.
Good question. Since once I did, I should know the answer. Since I did a few months ago, I should really know the answer. There is some subtlety, but it cancels. If you can do, for example, the Tuft expansion here, the first few terms, and you see that even if you keep it, the equation of motion will tell you that you have to set them to zero. Okay. So once you have this expression here, you solve it. This is a set of polynomials. So you get algebraic equation, you get delta V, the rho. And look that here there's a factor of t, the variable. So the result is not a constant, will be a function of t. And the kind of result that you find is the following. Let me draw pictures. So the behavior of the density is something like this. Is a piecewise linear function. And the delta V is slightly more complicated. It's not really linear, but it goes like 1 over t. And it has a behavior like this. This is delta V. Now, so what is this? What is this? Well, this is what you see from the numerics. At a certain point, the delta V becomes constant in the Largen limit, okay? Why is that? What are these constants? These constants appear precisely when these combinations here are 0 or 2 pi, okay? This is essentially the remnant of combination like this that appears in the in this guy here. And the point is that I wrote, so for example, I wrote the polylog, take the polylog 1 that enters in the equation of motion. The polylog 1 is something like a log of e to the I u tilde minus uj plus delta, something like that. Essentially, these values here correspond to the branch cuts of this function. The point is that you need to be careful about determination. So you do your computation with multi-valued function, you choose one determination, and numerics tells you that when you are well far from the cuts, everything is smooth, and you find a smooth solution. When the eigenvalue approach the cut, instead of going to the other determination, they freeze. And you can check that even analytically that this is true, because the point is that this particular quantity here, near the plateau, is suppressing powers of n. To be precise, what you discover by solving the analytic equations, this is actually non-trivial. First time I see something like that in matrix model, is that the effect in the Lagrangian limit is that you freeze things, okay? Think by analogy, Bose-Einstein condensation, right? At a certain point, the picture that you see on statistical mechanics is a line for the chemical potential. Obviously, at finite n, it's not a line. Everything is smooth. So this is not actually zero, but it's very small. You might expect that it's 1 over n, 1 over n squared, and so on. At the very beginning, we say it's 1 over n, 1 over n squared. Who cares? Let's throw this stuff away. No, it's not like that. It's even worse because it goes exponentially. This you can check from the equation by keeping the next order in the expansion. And it goes exponentially to 0. So that you say, OK, who cares? It's exponentially suppressed. Well, in doing this computation, you need to be very careful. When you plug this solution back here, you have many terms, including terms that come from, for example, here, when I is equal to j. Okay? When you exponentiate those terms, you will get something like this. Minus yi xi over x tilde j, okay? Delta v is precisely the difference of the arguments of these two guys here, so it's and this combination here is parametrizing precisely this guy here. So what happens on the plateau is that this guy goes to 1, not to 0, so logarithm of 0 is blowing up. So you immediately see that you have pieces in your matrix model that are blowing up on this plateau. That's also the reason why there are plateaus. So typically terms like this, you say, who cares? When you do matrix model, you have matrices, you have sum over I and j, and the typical first thing that you say, okay, whenever you have a sum over I and j, you get something that goes like n square. When you have sum over a single variable I, you get things that goes like n. So typically these are suppressed. You typically throw away in any large in any matrix model computation. But this is tricky, because if this difference was going like 1 over n, that was true. You will get n log n, which is small. But this dumb guy goes e to the minus square root of n. So this is e to the minus square root of n something. When you take the log, instead of getting n, you will get n from the sum, and you will get square root of n from the log. And n times square root of n is n to the 3 over 2. So these plateaus are quite important in the computation. You need to be taking account, you need to compute also the subleading corrections. And once you have everything, you go here, you plug it back, you do some computation, you need to be careful, otherwise the result is not correct. And finally, curiously enough, Everything simplifies, and the final result is pretty simple. The final result is pretty simple. So if you take the solutions of this beta equation and you plug it back in this functional W, you will get something very simple that depends on the chemical potential. I have four of them, and this is the result. Very simple function. And when you compute, when you take the solution, you plug it back, you compute the determinant, you are careful. Also from the determinant, you get contribution. So you need to be careful. You do everything carefully. Log of z also become very simple. Can be written as a derivative of this function here multiplied by the corresponding magnetic fluxes and sum from 1 to 4. Now, in the second, in the last 5 minutes, I will compare with the gravity result. Let me tell you that I cheated a little bit because, again, there are logs, polylogs, all multi-valued function. So in order to do this computation, you need to choose determination. You need to choose branch cuts and these kind of things. Actually, since the computation you can do with all possible choices of branch cuts, but if you do in a democratic choice of branch cuts where these angles go from 0 to 2 pi, the point is that the correct result, instead of being this one, is this one, where this guy is essentially delta A mod 2 pi. Again, there are periodicities, so you can restrict to a choice of determination, and you have this constraint. Remember that the sum over delta was should be an integer modulo 2 pi. Clearly, if you choose the guy in between 0 and 2 pi, cannot be 0. The sum, can be only if the deltas are 0. So this condition here becomes essentially a condition that this integer part should be either 0, but is the trivial case where all are 0. Can be 2 pi. Since you have four of them, you have a couple of choices to satisfy this condition, that is just a condition that the superpotential is invariant. And when you do explicitly computation, you should do the computation in all the possible cases to see if there is a solution. This is essentially trivial. This is trivial. Here you find no solution. Here you find a solution. So essentially, the solution with this choice exists when the sum of the delta is 2 pi. It also exists here. But you will discover that, okay, it's not an independent solution because there is a discrete symmetry of the matrix model that maps one into the other. Okay? So the correct result should be written in this way. Let me finish comparing gravity and field theory. Let me write a table, field theory on one side, gravity on the other. So localization is here. Localization, remember, logic is you compute the partition function. The entropy, as we discussed the very first day, is the Legendre transform with respect to the electric charges that I call QA of the logarithm of Z. Okay? So this you can write explicitly as using the formula that just erased, delta 1, delta 2, delta 3, delta 4, PA over delta A, okay, it enters in this way, minus I QA delta A. And there is a sum again, A equal 1, 4. So this is the, just to find the entropy, you need to do the Legendre transform. So you need to take the derivative with respect to delta, set them to zero, and plug it back delta. Okay, that's the meaning of Legendre transform. Remember this, and you will get this complicated function of P and Q. I show you an example the first day, okay? But this is the compact expression. And this is valid for sum over delta A equal to pi, real part of delta A in zero to pi, okay? So these are actually the guy I should better call this guy the mod 2 version of delta. But let not me complicate too much equations with that. Gravity, I need a slightly bigger part of the blackboard. Okay, maybe you remember this formula. I wrote it a couple of days ago. It's the attractor mechanism. Where G are the Fayeliopoulos, and for our black hole, as we discuss, all the electric ones are constant, equal to a particular parameter. This Fayeliopoulos is not the genus, sorry for the notation. F lambda is the derivative of a prepotential with respect to the sections. Prepotential was written 2 days ago, is this one. Then these are the charges that you typically find in supergravity literature. If you correctly quantize them using Dirac quantization condition, you get these expressions here. A couple of days ago, I gave you the expression, but essentially I choose a particular normalization for the volume of sigma without telling you. Now I'm general without choosing this. And the correct quantization condition is the following. Depends on the charges and Fayeliopoulos, P lambda. And there is a similar one for the electric charges. Depends on the volume for Gn, G lambda, Q lambda equal 2 pi, Q lambda square, where now P lambda hat and Q lambda hat are integer, okay? These are the normalization. Then you also, for example, open Marino lectures, and you go after the correct supergravity normalization of the Newton constant and Fayeliopoulos term. Fayeliopoulos is just a coupling, so you will find this information in Marino, and you discover that this is the result. And then you plug all the ingredients back here, okay? You plug all the ingredients back here, and something that you can do, this is zero, something that you can do very easily because this is homogeneous of degree one, and this is homogeneous of degree one, let's define this new variable, x hat, which are 2 pi x lambda divided sum over x lambda, which have the property that the sum over x lambda is equal to pi because of definition, okay? So you can reabsorb this guy here because the numerator is linear, and if you plug all this information, you will find the following. Lambda from 0 to 3, and to the 3 over 2 divided by 3, to x0, x1, x2, x3, p hat lambda divided x hat lambda minus I, q lambda, x hat lambda, where the p hat and q hat are the correctly normalized guy. Now you compare the two sides of the blackboard, this one and this, and you see immediately that if you send the field theory charges that are integers into the integer supergravity charges, and you send the delta A into the sections, there are four of them each, the two things are manifestly equal, okay? So there is no need of computing really the entropy. The field theory result is the localization result. Can I steal 2 minutes to finish? Yes. Okay. So the rest are just comments. One comment is the following. Here I write from 1 to 4. These are the electric charges. But remember that there are only 3 independent guys. So I can find the black hole entropy depending on 3 electric charges. But as I told you, indeed, the black hole only depends on 3 electric charges. So the point is that with this field theory computation, you cannot tell anything about the 4th electric charge. There is, in principle, a 4th electric charge that you can associate to their symmetry. What is the value of the charge associated to their symmetry for the black hole? From field theory, I cannot predict. From gravity, I can. Well, in principle, yes, in the gravity limit, you know that there is precisely one choice of this charge that makes a macroscopic black hole. In comparing the entropy, you don't need this information. Gravity chooses also the other charge. So the expectation is that maybe there is another field theory computation, not this one, not the topological twisted, something else, maybe the topological twisted integral with insertion of currents and so on, that also compute the value of the 4th charge that you can compare with gravity. This is the first comment. Okay. I'm quite below schedule, so I cannot comment much about other results in this set of topics. Let me just mention a few of them, and you find more references in the notes. So this field theory computation you can generalize to any two-dimensional field theory, any quiver. So there are many theories for M2-brain. If you want to know what is the corresponding topologically twisted index, you use the same trick, goes over. And you discover a set of interesting things. For example, this function here that appear in this way, which was the value of delta of the twisted superpotential on shell, curiously enough, is also something that looks completely unrelated. If you look at the literature, people compute in the large N limit the value of the free energy on S3. Okay, and as a function of R charges of the three-dimensional theory, and the expression that you find is precisely the same. There are reasons, and maybe you will see some next week in, I don't know, Willett or Closet talks. Unfortunately, there are not so many black holes associated with these quivers. There is a class of black hole which is in massive type 2A, which is as simple as the one in ABJM. And in massive type 2A, you have a Chern-Simons theory with UN, gauge theory, and Trier joint. And the matching has been explicitly done by Kirill there, Osseni, Passias is there, Francesco, Milan, what's the name of the? Catrestriano. It was done last year and matches perfectly. Then Leo and collaborators went beyond the large N limit. There are interesting logarithmic correction to the entropy. Here is a log of N. They were able to extract it numerically from the matrix model and compute the same in gravity. There are many other results related to the fact that people see the log of Z and start asking, okay, the log of Z is a free energy. I should be able to find in not as an entropy, but as a on-shell value of the gravitational action after holographic renormalization, and indeed you can. There are papers by Almaggi, again, Leo, Papadimitriou, and Cavo Bizet is also here somewhere. Okay, so you can, this you can check. And finally, there is a big game also with localization and supergravity. You saw the asymptotically flat version in Samir's lecture. Localization in for ADS black hole has been started by Kirill, Val Rice is not here, and Ivan Olodato. They computed, at least for the moment, the classical part of the action, then I think they are computing the one loop, and we wait for this result. This would be a quantum gravity result that you, in principle, you should correspond to the full matrix model, not only in the large end limit. And finally, and with this I stop, this game works very well in 4D. If you try to do this similar kind of computation for five-dimensional black hole, the electrically charged black hole that I mentioned the first lecture, you will discover that the problem is that you compute an index, trace of minus one to the f is not, strictly speaking, the entropy, and for this kind of black hole, minus one to the f leads to big cancellation, so you get something of order one. Nevertheless, it's quite interesting. I have no time to discuss it, obviously, but you can repackage the entropy of this five-dimensional, seven-dimensional black hole in terms of very simple things. So if you ask, are they the Legendre transform of something very simple like this function here? The answer is yes, and what you get is something that looks pretty much a coefficient in some anomaly polynomial of the gauge theory. So, and this is not trivial because the entropy is really a mess when it's written in terms of electric charges and rotations. But still, there is this observation that, that is a sort of smoking gun, that you can rewrite the entropy as the Legendre transform of something that it has a field theory meaning. The computation with localization is still missing, and clearly, if someone of you can find a way of computing from field theory, it would be a quite nice result. Okay, sorry for being late, and I stop here.